Good morning, brothers and sisters. Welcome to morning prayer. Let us begin. Through Jesus, let us continually offer to God the sacrifice of praise, that is the tribute of our lips which acknowledge his name. Lord, open my lips that my mouth may proclaim your praise. Hear us, O Lord, for your mercy is great. We will exalt you, O God, our Savior, and praise your name forever and ever. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Let us pray. Father, we come together in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, to offer you our worship, praise, and thanksgiving. To you belong all power and glory. You are the source of all goodness. Let our worship bear witness to your peace and saving power. Through your Spirit, may we ever rejoice in the abiding presence of our risen and ascended Lord. Amen. The Jubilate. O shout to the Lord in triumph, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness, and come before his face with songs of joy. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Come into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his holy name. For the Lord is good. His loving mercy is forever. His faithfulness throughout all generations. Glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Lord, we pray to you for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Set us free, O God, from the bondage of our sins, and give us the liberty of that abundant life which you have made known to us in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Psalms appointed for today are Psalms 107, verses 33 to 43, and 108. Psalm 107, verses 33 to 43, and Psalm 108.
Psalm 107. The Lord changed rivers into deserts, and water springs into thirsty ground.
A fruitful land into salt flats, because of the wickedness of those who dwelt there.
He changed deserts into pools of water, and dry land into water springs.
He settled the hungry there, and they founded a city to dwell in.
They sowed fields and planted vineyards and brought in a fruitful harvest.
He blessed them so that they increased greatly. He did not let their herds decrease.
Yet when they were diminished and brought low through stress of adversity and sorrow,
he pours contempt on princes and makes them wander in trackless wastes.
He lifted up the poor out of misery and multiplied their families like flocks of sheep.
The upright will see this and rejoice, but all wickedness will shut its mouth.
Whoever is wise will ponder these things and consider well the mercies of the Lord.
Psalm 108. My heart is firmly fixed, O God, my heart is fixed. I will sing and make melody.
Wake up, my spirit, awake, lute and harp. I myself will waken the dawn.
I will confess you among the peoples, O Lord. I will sing praises to you among the nations.
For your loving kindness is greater than the heavens, and your faithfulness reaches to the clouds.
Exalt yourself above the heavens, O God, and your glory over all the earth,
so that those who are dear to you may be delivered. Save with your right hand and answer me.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
A reading from the Word of God, written in the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 22, verses 17 to 29. After I had returned to Jerusalem, and while I was praying in the temple, I fell into a trance, and saw Jesus saying to me, "Hurry and get out of Jerusalem quickly, because they will not accept your testimony about me." And I said, "Lord, they themselves know that in every synagogue I imprisoned and beat those who believed in you. And while the blood of your witness Stephen was shed, I myself was standing by, approving and keeping the coats of those who killed him." Then he said to me, "Go, for I will send you far away to the Gentiles." Up to this point, they listened to him. But then they shouted, "Away with such a fellow from the earth, for he should not be allowed to live." And while they were shouting, throwing off their cloaks and tossing dust into the air, the tribune directed that he was to be brought into the barracks and ordered him to be examined by flogging to find out the reason for this outcry against him. But when they had tied him up with thongs, Paul said to the centurion who was standing by, "Is it legal for you to flog a Roman citizen who is uncondemned?" When the centurion heard that, he went to the tribune and said to him, "What are you about to do?" "This man is a Roman citizen." The tribune came and asked Paul, "Tell me, are you a Roman citizen?" And he said, "Yes." The tribune answered, "It cost me a large sum of money to get my citizenship." Paul said, "But I was born a citizen." Immediately, those who were about to examine him drew back from him, and the tribune also was afraid, for he realized that Paul was a Roman citizen and that he had bound him. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Song of the Redeemed. O ruler of the universe, Lord God, great deeds are they that you have done, surpassing human understanding. Your ways are ways of righteousness and truth. O King of all ages, who can fail to do you homage, Lord, and sing the praises of your name? For you only are the Holy One. All nations will draw near and fall down before you, because your just and holy works have been revealed. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
Reading from the Word of God, written in the Gospel according to Mark, chapter 11, verses 1 to 11. When they were approaching Jerusalem, at Bethphage and Bethany, near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this: 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here immediately.'" They went away and found a colt tied near a door, outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks in the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
So we know this story very well. It's the story that we use, or we hear mostly on Palm Sunday, when Jesus enters into Jerusalem and palms are laid and people are praising and celebrating his entry as he comes in on this donkey. And I mean, if we remember correctly, Jesus was there before. He was all over, going all over, but running from, or hiding basically, to make sure that his identity is not known. But here we have where he says openly, "Tell them the Lord needs it." And so we have God, we have Jesus saying and admitting who he is. And if we remember the scriptures well, or if we knew, the people were expecting, they were waiting on this Messiah, they were waiting on this help to come, based on the prophecies that were told before, the psalms that were sung, the stories being told before. So they had knowledge and were expecting. I'm not sure, and we don't know if they really knew deep down that this was Jesus. And we could guess and assume that based on the fact that they abandoned him at his, the, I want to say at his time of need, Not that you really needed them, but in our human sense, what we would see as his time of need, when they gave him over to Pilate and said, crucify him, crucify him. But I don't want us to go down there yet. There we have as well Paul. Paul, who was this new convert, because he was Saul right before. If we read back, we would see where he was persecuting the people and thinking that what he was doing was right. He thought that he was serving God in the right way. And he was Saul at the time, and there Jesus made himself, Jesus was present or in his face basically, and told him, why are you persecuting my people? And so he was then blinded at that time, and then his vision was, Ananias gave him back his vision and so forth. And here we now have Jesus sending him out to the, he's sending him to a different place, because he says, you know, you can't stay in this place. You were persecuting the people. You were killing. Nobody's going to listen to you. So go to the Gentiles. And that's where we are. So there Paul is standing up and he's talking to the people and he's saying some things that seems like blasphemy to them and all sorts of weird things to them. And so a fight breaks out. And in the midst of this fight, here comes the ruler, and he says, okay, Paul is causing trouble and havoc, and we can't have that. So he has him basically arrested. It doesn't say arrested, but taken away. And he says, flog him and let's find out what it is really going on. Let him speak the truth as to why he is causing all of this ruckus. And Paul then says to him, are you going to flog a Roman? Now, of course, the Romans had rules, they had laws that you can't do that just like that. He has to receive a proper trial. Now you see the problem, right? But we're not talking about that disadvantage where you could grab somebody because they're not a Roman and you could do them anything. But here Paul says, because of his citizenship, he has rights, and his rights is that he must receive a fair trial and then determine if he should be flogged or not, instead of just flogging him and so forth. And so he then confesses his identity or shows persons his true identity, that he's a Roman, and that they must abide by these rules and so forth. I love it. And I want us to ask ourselves a simple question. Who are we? So Jesus points out his identity. Jesus admits his identity. Paul confesses that he is a Roman by birth. Who are we? And I want to use the word identity, because if I say, who are you, or who are we? We automatically start to talk about John and Jill and James and Mary and Joanne and whoever else, and we point fingers at everybody else except looking at or admitting who we are, who I am personally. And so the question is, identity. What is your identity? Notice it starts with an I, so I'm not talking about anybody else. What is my identity? Who am I? And I want to talk about, now we don't have all of the time in the morning. We don't have hours to go through this whole identity aspect. And so some of it, we must do some research on our own. But I want us to look at our Christian identity. Of course, we will look at the word identity itself. And I want to talk about mistaken identity or false identity and true identity. Of course, anyway, we will not talk about who identifies as. No, we're not going there. But in psychology, identity is the qualities, beliefs, personality, looks, expressions that make a person or a group. The process of identity can be creative or destructive. Simple. Now, it is important for us to consider our identity, and we're looking at mistaken or false identity versus true identity. We're talking Christian identity, because we are confessing and admitting and telling everybody that we are Christians. And for a lot of us, we have formed or shaped our identity based on the fact that we may have grown up in church and these are the practices. But our identity, our Christian identity, is not about how many things that we have done, how many groups we have led, or groups that we belong to. But it is about us. It is about us understanding the person of God acted out in our daily lives. It is about us understanding the person that is God acted out in our daily lives. You know, they talk about when you've learned something, not just having knowledge of something, but when you've truly learned that it becomes part of you. It becomes your daily, in your daily living and exercise. And if we look at the way we live and the things that we have done and so forth, can we truly say that we are Christians? Is it our true identity? You see, if I ask you again, who are you? You would start telling me about all of the things that you have achieved in your daily life. You talk about your age, you'll call me, you'll say your name, and you will talk about you've held this position for so long, and then you might even talk about you retired as this, and now you are this. And of course, you know, we have to put on the voice that goes with it. Oh, I am the heir that goes with it. As though it is the greatest feat that we can achieve, our greatest accomplishment. But our greatest accomplishment, really and truly, brothers and sisters, is eternal life. And that is not determined by other people. It is determined by God. We have to fit the criteria, we have to fit the bill. And that means us first looking at who we are. Looking at who we are in its true and natural sense, and looking at who we should be based on this Christian walk. It is defined by boundaries, it is defined by rules. If we call ourselves Christians, then there are certain things that are required of us, certain things that we must do. And brothers and sisters, we must understand that us figuring out our identity is not just about us, you know, it's about our children, it is about our grandchildren, it is about the people around us and who we interact with. When we are able to admit who we are and be true to who we are, there's all over scripture that talks about who we are and whose we are, but we have to first believe it. We have to then walk it. We have to then embody it. And so again, who are you? What is my identity? And that's the question we must ask ourselves. What is my identity? Who are you? Who do you think you are? And how do you think about yourself? How does the world view you? What are the characteristics that define who you are? And now I will ask you who you are as a Christian. There are distinguishing characteristics that define or identify us, or personality traits that define us as an individual and says to people who we are. The way we act, the things we say, the things we say versus the way we act, the things we do. The thing about identity is that identity is determined based on continuity, meaning what we do most consistently, what we're doing all the time, and what. So just to give the example, if we are saying that we are Christians, and yet when you go to church on Sunday, we're very pious, we're holy, we're doing all sorts of things and being nice to others for the most part, and then service is over and we're mean and we're aggressive and we don't want to share and we don't want to drop anybody, Or we're there in church and people come in and we're hostile and we're aggressive and we're judgmental and we're looking down at people, then the identity they are being shown to us or to others who are looking on is not that of Christians, but of persons lost in the world. Because as Christians, as believers, we're supposed to exercise love. We're supposed to exercise peace. We're supposed to be peacemakers, yes. We're supposed to be forgiving. And for a lot of us, we allow our emotions, hurts, pains, fears, and so forth, to determine how we act and who we become. And this is why it is important for us to keep looking at ourselves. And I hold to the word, who are we? Who are you? What is your identity? Because, you know, every time I talk about looking at ourselves and I give the examples, we get lost and people call me all the time or the message to say, you know, excellent sermon, Rev. And then they talk about how other people are doing this and people don't realize. And we don't realize that we are doing exactly what the other people were pointing out doing. We're not trying to get better. We're not trying to do better. We're not trying to, because we want to focus on others. And when we keep focusing on what other people are doing and not looking to see how we can improve on our walk, then we are failing just as they are. And so it's important for us to look at ourselves. As Christians, we have to take care of each other. We have to be kind to one another. And then we look in the individual sense, we must strengthen our walk with God. We have to do it. We can no longer walk around pretending that we are. And that is identity theft, you know. And that's why I said we have to look at false identities or identity theft. Because we make this big joke, and I'm using the terms that we're in now. The time that we're in, these are the terms. Identity theft. When somebody takes the information and identity of somebody else and use it as their own. And that is what we keep doing. We keep pretending to be people we are not by saying that we are Christians. Yet there's no love in our hearts. We're not sharing with one another. We're not kind to one another. We're not even thinking about each other. We're not even caring for one another. And we're not trying to strengthen our resolve in God. We're not trying to strengthen our relationship with God. We're not trying to be better for God, because we are his ambassadors. We are his units down here who go out and really liaison officers and so forth to say to the people, hey, come to God. Hey, come and see what he is offering. But our behaviors and attitudes tell people, I don't want to see. If that's what he has to offer, I'm not interested. And that is the whole thing. And this is why I say I'm happy to talk about identity. Because here Jesus says to the people, tell them the Lord wants it. And they automatically respond. Man says, yes, take the donkey, you go ahead. Imagine somebody come to steal the donkey, your donkey, something of yours. And I mean, we could think about the attitude and the emotions that the guy might have. What are you doing? And he's ready to call the police or the authorities there and so forth. And they said, just as Jesus would have predicted, just as Jesus showed them, right? Because he said in advance where to find it. He's now going to this place. He's now going to this place. How does he know where this donkey is? Because he's God. And so he says, you will find the donkey at this place. And when they ask you, tell them the Lord needs it. So therefore, he knew exactly what was going to happen. He knew when and where and all of that. So there he's further proving to his disciples who he is. And so often God proves to us who he is, but we're not paying attention. And they responded by being obedient to him. And this is the part where we get lost. We're not being obedient. We're not following the direction that he gave. We just still keep trying to do it our own way. And we're doubting and we're getting lost. I mean, and if we continue, if we pay attention to ourselves, our actions, and the things that we have been doing, the identity, then we are going to pull ourselves back when we get lost. Pull ourselves back when we realize that, hey, You know, God really showed me this and I was not paying attention. But we want to hold others to certain standards and not hold ourselves. So because, and I'm giving a straight example, because I am a reverend, I wear a color, right? People want to hold me to a certain standard. So I must not do, and you make your own list. Everybody makes their own list. And they say, well, no, this is how it is. And I say, okay. And so they make this whole long list of things that I should not do. But what makes me different from you? We're all walking the same walk. We're all trying, and I'm using this word loosely, supposed to be trying to have a relationship with God. We're all calling ourselves believers and Christians, each having our own work to do. This is my job. But why are we holding others to a certain standard and not having a standard for ourselves? Developing and forming our own morals and values, our own, for ourselves, I mean, standards of living and holding firm. We don't even have to work on it, you know. It's written in our scriptures telling us who to be and how to act. And we could use the Beatitudes as one to guide us. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed. So basically, the humble, the meek, the kind, the use the Beatitudes. We could use in Galatians, we could use the fruits of the Spirit to guide us and help us to understand who we ought to be all the time in our thinking, in our behaviors, in our responses, in our attitudes. Brothers and sisters, we're locked up. We're in a pandemic, and we now at, and I say it all the time, reset. It is where we have are forced to stop and think about ourselves, think about what we've been doing, and recognize that. Because we get lost all the time. Let us stop being defined by the abilities, by our number of passes or degrees or our skills, but let us be defined, or let our identities be defined by our Christian walk, our walk with God, that we can help others come to God. Brothers and sisters, this is our time to check ourselves so that when Or so that our new normalcy, our new way of living, is true way of living in Christ. I mean, if we think about it, like Noah's Ark, they're starting over. When when we look back at how things were going and the world was going and how we were living, we lost our way. We forgot God. We spent so much time doing so many other things, and of course the first section of this pandemic had us at a loss. Oh, we can't do this, and we want to do this, and we can't go anywhere, and we can't move around as the way we like, and so forth. But then we've adjusted. Look at it. Look at the way we've been living, the things that we have been doing. Look at how our children have turned out. Look at the state of our grandchildren coming up, with the people around us. And ask yourself, how has my living, the person that I identify as, who I am, how have I contributed to that negative way of living? And now, ask and pray to God to help you to change, to be a better person. I mean, and it doesn't come all at once. Eh? You just take one thing at a time. Improve on one thing. Maybe it's the way you speak to people. Maybe it's the blind eye you throw at people and their situations. You look away and it's like, well, that's not my business. I'm not getting into that. Maybe try seeing, how can I help? Maybe it's the negativity. Every time something happens, you run straight to say, well, that will never come off, or that will not be like that. And people, and please, you know, I'm already envisioning somebody messaging me to say, you know, where you could say all of that, but people will not change. This is not about people in its wide context, but it is about you. It is not what other people are going to do, but it is about what you and your individuality, who you are in Christ, who you are as a Christian. Are you true? Are you false? And if you are false, then stop being false and start being true. And this is not about the way you behave to say I identify as a Christian, but your attitudes are different from what a Christian attitude should be. And that is loving, caring, kindness. That is being holding firm to your belief in God. That is about you walking daily and your life reflecting God. That's the identity that we ought to be striving for. And I'm not saying you shouldn't be rich or poor. I'm not saying that you should have houses or you should achieve high positions, because Paul had a high position. But Paul didn't lord himself over others. Paul used his position. Paul used his high position to bring knowledge about God to others. Paul used his high position not to lord himself over people of a lower standard. No. As a matter of fact, to show them that regardless of what position I am in or someone is in, God can use them. So allow God to use you and stop lording yourself over others. Because just as much as he granted it to you, is as much he can take it away. Because it's not about what you have gathered up for yourself, but it is about how you have grown in Christ. Our relationship or our understanding of God acted out in our daily lives. And so I ask you, who are you in Christ? Amen.
Temptations lose their power when thou
I invite us to continue by professing our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. O Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Lord, reveal your love among us, that we may know the joy of our salvation. Grant peace within and among all nations, and teach our leaders wisdom. Endow your church with faithfulness, and your servants with knowledge and true godliness. Defend, O Lord, the rights of the poor and the oppressed, that your justice may be known among all people. Lord, renew your spirit within us, and in us and through us, your will may be done. Grant to us, Lord, we pray, the spirit to think and do always those things that are right, that we, who cannot exist without you, may by you be enabled to live according to your will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Eternal God and Father, by whose power we are created and by whose love we are redeemed, guide and strengthen us by your Spirit, that we may give ourselves to your service and live this day in love for you and one another. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. At this time we offer to God our own petitions. Let us pray for those who influence public opinion. Sorry. Almighty God, you proclaim your truth in every age by many voices. Direct in our time, we pray, those who speak where many listen and write what many read, that they may do their part in making the heart of this people wise, its mind sound, and its will righteous, to the honor of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We pray the prayer of dedication. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. May it be a lantern to our feet, a light to our paths, and a strength to our lives. Take us and use us to love and serve all persons, in the power of the Holy Spirit, and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May the God of hope fill us with all joy and peace in believing, through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. Do have a wonderful weekend, everyone.